More and more people without a job. Stimulus check ran out long ago. The debt has skyrocketed and the solution will simply be higher taxes, which will under no circumstances fill the void. As a result, cuts to unfunded liabilities will happen, pensions will be slashed also. Fewer jobs and less services. This is the future you're walking into, one in which Wall Street magic cannot fix. You came here for the truth, so let me unveil that for you. Today we're going to talk about the economic situation that has taken place, and trust me, it's not good. When we look at the data, it is overwhelming. And they keep telling us that everything is going to be okay, that there's going to be a V-shaped recovery, but I'm going to show you the statistics right now that says otherwise. There's a lot of information here. This video itself is just a small piece of the puzzle. You know, if you've been watching this channel, that I am constantly updating you on the different statistics. We have seen some indicators that have turned up, but at this point here, we are still in a very critical moment. It is completely different than what we have seen in the stock market, particularly with the top five stocks, the FANG stocks, the tech stocks. They have performed extremely well throughout this period. We are looking at the economy. We're looking at the job situation. A lot to cover. Let's begin. The market loved this information. Total of those receiving unemployment benefits falls below 20 million. Wow, so great. The weekly jobless claims totaled 1.48 million last week. That's worse than the 1.35 million that Wall Street had projected. Continuing claims fell to 19.5 million people. California accounted for the biggest surge in claims, over 1 million for the 14th straight week. So we can see what has been happening here to the job situation, particularly affecting areas like California. A big portion of the GDP is focused around that one state. So you know when they're taking a hit, when you're looking for that consumer to be there and they aren't, this is going to have an impact when you look at the stats nationally. Initial claims for unemployment insurance, you could see here the weekly claims that have gone down certainly from the peak, but it is still going on and this is expected to persist for a long period. Here we are looking at how this has been going back to, let's say, 2007 or so up until today. It's been drastic, it's been dramatic, and I just wanted to give you an update on that. Here's the continuing claims for unemployment insurance, and you could see what's been happening here. It has declined somewhat, and they're trying to make it seem as though this is fantastic, V-shaped recovery and so on. But we're still talking about basically 20 million people that are part of this stat. That's huge. And we are not accounting for so many others that don't end up on these reports, that don't end up on these statistics. But the one point that I want to make here is that we were told by now the recovery would be totally on and so on. And here we are, we're looking at the real data and it doesn't add up to what they had expected. Here you can see the American jobs in the millions, left-hand side, payroll jobs created since 2010. It looks approximately 22, 23 million. On the right-hand side, lost jobs in the last 14 weeks. That's approximately 46, 47 million. It's shocking to see this. I like to pull up this chart as often as possible just to give you an idea of what's been happening week by week, to give you a look at the comparison in between these two. The annualized GDP is showing minus 5%, and this is with the expectation that don't worry, the third quarter is going to be fine, fourth quarter is going to be fantastic, and as we go into 2021, it's going to be the best ever. The quarterly data, and you look at monthly data, it does not make sense at all when you compare it to what they're projecting. Here you can see the quarterly GDP by component breakdown. This just gives you an idea, the estimates here, Q1 of 2020. Remember, whenever they give you this information, it's always coming out early. The revisions afterwards, nobody ever cares about it. Nobody ever looks at it. It usually looks worse, the situation, when it comes to jobs, when it comes to GDP and everything else. Most cases, it always looks worse. But by then, the stock market, the analysts and so on, they don't care about it because it's old news. They only care about that first print. I've been covering the situation with the jobs, and you can see the store closures have had a big impact on what we're looking at. And you can see one of those examples being Macy's. Macy's 2/3900 corporate jobs in restructuring. It's not necessarily just the retail industry specifically, but the corporate jobs are getting hit too. Macy's said it's cutting 3% of its workforce to reduce costs as it struggles with the effects of what's happening here in 2020. This number of 3% will likely grow. It's probably going to be more like 100% eventually, and we'll see what happens as time goes on. CEC Entertainment, this is Chuck E. Cheese, and you're looking at a company that, of course, is in many, many cities, and yet they're going bankrupt. This is just one more company that's gone through this Chapter 11 process. It won't be the last. How many store closures will there be? How many jobs will be impacted? Right now, if you look at the core site data, the one who tracks all of the store closures, it's embarrassing because it's so off. And I know there's a lot of uncertainty right now. There are many small businesses that aren't even sure if they're going to close yet, but likely a lot of them will. The numbers that I saw were something like 3,000 store closures for 2020. We know the number is a lot higher. So I'm willing to wait it out here a little bit to see how bad it's going to be. We know it's a lot higher than 3,000. You may be aware of the app and the website Yelp. Well, check this out. Roughly 140,000 Yelp-listed businesses that had closed since March 1st remain closed on June 15th. A large minority of that set, 41%, has shut for good. Now, this is big. This is huge, in fact. Yelp is going to give us some data. We're getting data from OpenTable on the restaurants. These are really, really good indicators. We're getting it from these sources, and we're piecing it together. This is really important to focus on all of this type of data instead of looking at the fake U3 unemployment rate, which I consistently see basically on a daily basis, being reported as 13.3%. I think is the number. The articles constantly focus on this number of 13.3%, even though it is a fact. The Labor Department admitted it, that it should be significantly higher, but they're not going to change it. I've already covered this before, broke it down completely of why that's the case, but this is what you get. This is what you get when you're not looking at that, what I call second and third tier type of information. When you look at just one of these type of stats, you might shrug it off. You might say, hey, who cares? But when you look at a money GPS video and you start to connect all these dots, okay, then things start making sense. That's what I'm trying to do. I hope I'm getting that across to you. At the bottom here, you can see the number of businesses listed on Yelp that are marked temporarily or permanently closed. This color here being, of course, permanent. This is temporary, and you can compare on the left-hand side, shopping and retail, and we move over to restaurants, beauty and spas, and fitness. For shopping and retail, it is not good. 35% of this is being affected. It's showing here 27,000 closures. Nobody has any idea what the final number will be, whether we're even going to be able to get accurate data, but it will be historic. And that means not only do a lot of the business owners get affected by it, the people who are relying on this income are going to be hurt severely. This is an article out of Bloomberg, and it's talking about real estate. Check this out. It reads like the script for the business version of a disaster movie. Office buildings lose 40% of their value. A third of hotels go bankrupt. Residential rents plummet. According to this guy right here, this is the real life future for New York real estate. Essentially, what he's saying is that in this case here, he moved out of New York, went to Miami because of the tax burden. So many people are doing the same thing. If they raise taxes, more people leave, and the social burden of those that are less fortunate falls on an ever smaller revenue base. The services of the city get worse. The city gets dirtier. You know you've got problems here. If you look at what's been happening to the population of New York, it's been shrinking, and that's not a good thing, particularly if people in the higher income incomes are the ones leaving. That's not a good thing. Many times they are doing the same thing. They're leaving New York. They're going to places like Florida. They don't want to pay the taxes. They don't want to deal with all the bureaucracy. And it's not just a handful of people. This is now becoming a big trend. New York's not the only place, of course. A lot of individuals have left California. It should tell you something about what's going on here. People are so burdened by the taxation and the regulations and so much more. It makes it difficult to have economic growth under those conditions. UCLA Anderson forecast says U.S. economy is in, quote, depression-like crisis and will not return to pre-recession peak until 2023. This is huge. We have to see, of course, what happens. And I do think there's always going to be pockets. If you look around the United States, you're going to see one area that certainly will recover faster than others. There's no doubt about it. This report here will tell you some of the information you need to know about what's happening today. But it is very clear that the weakness is going to be there for a long period of time. U.S. tax and debt expectations over the next year. This is not good at all. See, this orange line right here is government debt, and it has skyrocketed tremendously. On the other hand, taxation is basically not able to keep up at all. In fact, even if they do raise taxes, it is impossible for it to ever pay off the amount of debt that they have accumulated. If you tax every single person, rich, middle class, doesn't matter, at 100% of their income, you will not be able to pay off the expenses in that given year. Think about that. If every single person in the nation gave up 100% of their salary to the taxes, they still couldn't pay everything off. And I'm talking about within that given year. That is how in trouble these governments are. It's not just the United States. That is pretty much pervasive all around the world. Jim Cramer, my friend and yours, had this to say. He worries about the stocks after their big, quote, 1999-like rally from the March lows. I'm feeling uncertain here after a very big run, fourth quarter 1999-like. Of course, he is long-term bullish. That shouldn't surprise anybody. But I just wanted to note at this point here, when you look at Jim Cramer, you've got to take it with a grain of salt. He's talking for a long period of time. He's there every day. He's going to say things that maybe make sense today, but literally 4 hours later, suddenly that's not the case. So take whatever you hear from any one of these people, whether they're traders, whether they're news anchors or analysts, very lightly, because there are moments in time when that information might be true. Some new information comes through and suddenly it negates that. Bank stocks surge after regulators ease the Volcker Rule. JP Morgan Chase climbs 2%. So after the Great Recession, they put in some restrictions, and they did so in order to prevent a financial crisis. They eased the rule so that they can do more, that they can push harder, that they can take more risk. Why would they do this right now if there wasn't a problem? You've got to explain that to me, because clearly it doesn't make sense. At the same time, there's stuff going on with the stress test. The Fed said that there are some structural problems. The Federal Reserve had recently just brought the reserve requirements down to nothing. There is many facets to this. I don't have time to get into them in this video, but hopefully I will be able to cover that either tomorrow or sometime soon. Look at what we're dealing with today. I referenced this earlier in the video. Giant 5 as a percentage of the Wilshire 5000 market cap is nearly 20%. Apple, Microsoft, Amazon, Google, Facebook, nearly 20% of the Wilshire 5000. It has essentially doubled since the beginning of 2017 up until today. It tells you something about what's happening, where the money is flowing into, and who stands to gain. Corporate profits, on the other hand, they're not important, clearly. No matter what these profits show, no matter how bad the situation is, as long as the Federal Reserve is pumping it up, buy the dip will be the mentality. That's all for this video. If you found it informative, hit that thumbs up button. When you do, you are supporting me. I want to thank you for that. Click that like button before you leave to support me. Thank you very much. If you want to check me out on Instagram and Twitter, you can do so at TheMoneyGPS. So you want to make some money. So you want to earn an income that is maybe a supplement to your 9-to-5 job, or maybe you want to replace it altogether. E-commerce is very interesting, but there's a lot of garbage out there, a lot of confusing material. I created a free e-course. That's right. It's free. Free for my subscribers. Check it out at theamazongps.com. If you want to understand the financial system, if you want to ask the right questions, these two books will give you all what you need. Check it out, link in description, audiobook at themoneygps.com. Wait a second, don't go anywhere. Have you seen this video? There's a lot of good information in here that you need to check out, so definitely do so. Click it, I'll see you there.